time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will.
Poor People's Campaign .org/June 18th. Good morning, Sharon, my sister.
Good morning, my sister. How you doing?
I'm good. How are you? How you doing?
I'm blacknificent. Blessed and highly favored.
I hear you. I hear you. So I wanted to bring you ladies on because we are all delegates for the Democratic Convention. Mm-hmm. And this was actually my...
Thank you, Sharon. Appreciate you. Good morning, everybody. This is People Power with Priscilla. We are the people and we have the power. And there is so much going on in this city and this state because we have a major election going on this year. Well, we have a major election every year. So, but our folks, for some reason, don't want to get involved unless it's a governor's race or a president's race. But we need to stop that. We need to get involved, whether it's any type of race, whether it's an NAACP race or city council race or a state rep or a state senate. We need to get involved with our community. My guest will be in. We're going to be talking about the changes that the T is making. Mella will be in soon. She is with the T Writers Union. And so I'm going to wait and see if she makes it in. We talked last night and she said that she would be here because there's a lot of changes going on with this T that I don't believe a lot of us don't know about. And so I want to talk about, there's a meeting next Monday, it's next Monday, but it's not June. That's why I wish she was here, but yeah, they're having a meeting at their office at 2201 Washington Street, Suite 302 in Roxbury, and this is ACE. And so we were going to be talking about the changes that are being made that the T is doing. They're rerouting a lot of the T stops, and it really it's crazy if you ask me. However, they also changed the bus lanes in the city. So I was hoping that Mella would be here and we could talk about this because there's a lot of changes. And I know if I just go down them and read them, you'll probably fall asleep because there's so much. So so I'm going to see if she comes in. And until she comes in, my guest will be Eric Kennedy. Good morning, Eric.
Good morning.
How are you?
I'm doing well.
Yeah, there is a lot of stuff that's going on. I see that Kevin Hayden, who's our district attorney, who's running to be district attorney, was just here with Kevin Peterson. So There's a lot of politics and a lot of politics going on in the city of Boston. I got that word politics from T. Michael, and it so fits some of our politicians, I'm telling you. And so this is People Power with Priscilla. We are the people, and we have the power. So I guess it's open mic today, and if you have any questions, you want to talk politics, you want to talk community development, you want to talk education, you want to talk, I don't know enough about the new police commission, but I did hear that we do have a new police commission whose name is Michael Cox. And so I'm hoping maybe Larry is listening. He could call in. There's a lot of things going on in Boston. So come call in 617-282-0685, 617-282-7794. Or 617-265-2679. And this is People Power with Priscilla. So I guess I can talk a little bit, unless Eric got something he want to talk about.
Now, I know the topic was about the changes that T are making, but one of the changes that they made, you know, because everybody was fearing another fare hike, but it wasn't to the one-time ride thing. It was for all the passes. Mm-hmm. And lo and behold, they didn't go up. They actually went down.
Really? Price.
So I was shocked to see that.
What went down? The transfers?
The passes, like the 7-day link pass, the 1-day link
pass. Oh, okay, okay.
They actually went down.
Really?
In price, which I was just like shocked. I was like, wow, okay. And that took effect July 1st of you know, not too long ago, a few weeks ago.
So how much is a one week pass? Would that be for the bus and train?
Yeah, so that's the 1-day link pass was that went down $1.75 from $12.75 to $11.
Mm-hmm.
And then
that's for 1 day.
Yeah, that's the 1-day pass.
And that's for the subway or the bus?
That's for both.
Oh, okay.
So you can use that for both. You can get a transfer on buses as well.
Okay.
As long as the bus routes link. And the 7-day link pass, I believe, went down a couple of bucks as well. And they actually included a second bus transfer on it.
Really?
Yeah, so now you have two bus transfers when you use it, which kind of doesn't make sense because it's it's a monthly pass. It's a 7-day pass, so it's free. It's not like it's taking money off of you when you do it. You pay one time, and you have unlimited riding for those 7 days, so
right.
It doesn't matter.
And then after the 7 days,
right.
You got to start all over.
Right.
Okay.
So.
Well, I guess it would be good for people who are visiting the city.
Yeah.
And, you know, don't want to drive or Uber, mm-hmm. You know, so.
Yeah, a lot of people that come in for, like, the conventions and stuff, they usually grab that one, either the 7-day link pass or something like that. But if they're only here for 3 days, they usually
get 3 day.
No, they usually get the week pass and then just give it away to someone.
Oh, yeah. Well,
before they leave.
Well, that's nice of them.
Yeah.
So there are a lot of conventions and things that are coming back, huh?
Yeah, it's typically the convention season starts usually late February and goes until December, providing snow and stuff like that. But it's been really, really busy. And typically the first 2 weeks in July is like a hiatus because everybody's taking vacation time.
Mm-hmm.
And then it picks back up literally the 16th.
Of July?
Yeah. So from the 16th to the 27th, I'll be away again.
Well, speaking of the 16th, I am actually doing a book signing at the substation, 4228 Washington Street. That's on the corner of Washington and Cummins Highway in Roslindale, right there in the square, in the circle. I will be doing a book signing of my book, I Look Back and Wonder How I Got Over, from 12 noon to 2 p.m. So I hope you will come out and support me, purchase a book. If you already purchase one for a friend. How about that? And so, I think that's a good thing that, you know, that something actually went down with the T.
Yeah.
But these new routes look like they're taking people, I don't know. So I'm going to try to start. So if you currently ride the number one bus, right?
Mm-hmm.
Your new route is T1 Harvard to Back Bay to Nubian. It's the same route with more frequent late night service. Then there's one for North Station, the Financial District. That's T7 South Boston, South Station, Charlestown, Sullivan. So Route 7 extends to connect South Station to North Station to Sullivan, adding Orange, Green, and Blue Line access. Replaces 4 and 93. I guess those are the two buses. Mm-hmm. Improves to all-day high-frequency service. Adds new midday, evening, and weekend connections between Seaport, all subway lines, commuter rail, and Charlestown. I don't even understand these routes or where they go, where they come from. Northern Ave, Seaport, T7, T12, or Silver Line. Travel to T7 on Summer Street or use T12 or Silver Line nearby. I'm so confused.
So it sounds like because of the development in the Seaport District, they wanted a bus that goes down Northern Ave. And normally there's only two buses that usually go down into the seaport other than the Silver Line.
Mm-hmm.
And that was, those usually go down Summer Street. So there's another route that they added that's going to go down Northern Ave now.
Yeah. I don't take the bus that often. I would take the T more than I take the bus, but I'm glad I don't, because this whole page is full of changes. And I know people are going to be so confused, because I'm confused trying to read it. That's why I wish, I don't know what happened to Mella, but hopefully she's okay.
Mm-hmm.
But, yeah, so there's so much that's going on. There's so much building and construction, and it just really, I mean, it's just like someone just said, come to Boston, build all you want. You know, I mean, you look at NJP on Washington Street near Green Street Station. There's like two sites right opposite each other, mm-hmm, that they're building. If you go over to Dorchester, on Dorchester Ave, there's Dot Block. There's a big construction site over there. You look at Mattapan on Cummins Highway, the old Cody Ford building. There are apartments and things going up there. You look at Mattapan Station. There's apartments going up there. And so it's just like everywhere you look, Roxbury is getting ready to go through massive construction. And it's like they're doing all this building. They're building buildings, but they're not building people, you know? And it just doesn't, you know, to me, I don't understand why all these buildings are being built. And the people who are building them can't even afford to live in them, really. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, you don't have a lot of people that look like us on the jobs, you know? And so I'm like, I really want to know what is going to happen, you know, with the changes, what's going to happen with the new governors and the new auditors and attorney general. I mean, I'm curious, because these positions carry a lot of weight, but I don't really see a lot of change.
No.
And so how do we make these people who are running for office, who are in our face saying they, you know, they're going to do this, they're going to do that, how do we make them accountable? We need to have a accountability board that looks at all these elected officials and what they're doing and what they're not doing,
mm-hmm,
you know, because some of them are doing something and some of them aren't. Mm-hmm. And some of them didn't do anything before, and now they want a promotion to a bigger position.
Mm-hmm.
So what say you, Eric?
You know, I was in Nubian Square the other day walking through, and I went down one of the side streets across from the station,
mm-hmm,
and there's a new building that they built there, and they have like a doorman and everything. I'm like, this is
a
Nubian.
Doorman.
They have a doorman and everything, but all I saw walking out of the building were white folks.
Of course. Of course they would have the doorman, right?
I'm like, wow, a building in Nubian Square with a doorman and concierge and everything. I was just like, wow.
Unbelievable. And up the street they're selling Newports.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, really, it just doesn't make any sense. But you know that the times are changing. You can see it all over our city. You know, a lot of times, you know, with us being in elections and stuff, we do a lot of door knocking. And I'm telling you, you knock on some of these doors in Roxbury and all you see are white folks, you know? And so it's like, I don't have nothing against white people, but my problem is you all are gentrifying us out. That's basically it. And, you know, there are some black folks that are gentrifying us out either. But I would rather see black people come in and purchase and people of color as opposed to all these white people, because they have literally, they had it before.
Mm-hmm.
Then when all the riots and stuff came, they left a mess. And then, you know, Menino, he tried to build some of it back up. But why aren't we as black people thinking more collaboratively?
Mm-hmm.
Why aren't we looking at how can we pool our money together and purchase some of this land, put together some of these proposals, and really build something for us.
Trust issues.
That's so sad.
Yeah.
We trust the white man. Yeah. We think his ice is colder, mm-hmm. right? But it's not. And so I just wish that we would wake up in Boston, because Boston has the worst reputation. You know, first of all, are we still number one in income inequality? Are we still worth $8 and white people are worth $247,500? What is happening? What is changing in our city, mm-hmm. in our state, that makes it more accommodating for us people of color?
Mm-hmm.
How do we do this? How do we come together and not only hold our elected officials accountable, but we need to hold ourselves accountable too. Because mm-hmm. some of the stuff that's going on just doesn't make any sense. You know, why can't we sit down as a community and say, listen, let's work on this project. Let's see how we can get this done. You know, I don't see it happening. I might be out the loop.
One of the only times I really see our people coming together, and that's Black of all nations, is during the Caribbean Festival.
That's the only time ever.
That's the only time I see our people coming together and really having a good time and stuff like that. So if we can do it for that, why can't we do it for something more important?
I just don't understand that. You know, they said that the Caribbean Festival makes the most money of all those of all the parades in the city. You know, and so I'm like, why can't we do that all the time? Why can't
And it probably has the shortest route.
Yeah, because it goes up Warren. No, I think the Roxbury Day Parade has the shortest route. The one that Toy Burton does.
Okay.
Which will be happening this Sunday from 12 to 4. It's leaving at from Madison Park High School.
Mm.
So she does it every year. And I want to do a shout out to Toy, because she's really been doing a lot with her Dee Dee's Cry, you know, her program. And so it's good to have a Roxbury Day Parade. So hopefully I'll be able to attend this Sunday. It's this Sunday.
Mm-hmm.
And like I said, it leaves. I don't know if the route got longer, but the last time that I was in it, it went from Madison Park High School up MLK Boulevard to Washington Street and then up to MLK. That couldn't have been no more than 15 minutes.
Mm.
But there's a lot of elected officials and wannabe elected officials that participate in that parade, you know, so it's a fun time, so.
Yeah, I was thinking about the Caribbean Parade. That's less than a mile, but it takes all day because there's
it does. Because that's people come from
right.
other places just to come to this parade, you know. And it's funny because then the next week they pack up and they go to New York, York
yeah.
you know, so unbelievable. But yeah, it does take it's because people dance every 2 minutes. That's why, you know, you got them big old trucks,
oh,
and it's
man.
Just it's just a noisy time, but it's a fun
it's
a, time.
It is a fun time.
You know, I enjoy it, but I don't really participate. And I remember the last time I think I participated was in 2019, when I ran for office. I believe that was the last time I was part of the parade. But we have a caller. Good morning, caller. You're on the air.
Good morning, my sister.
Hey.
I'm not gonna bother you.
Hello, Larry.
Hey, yeah, we come together for the picnics and all of that stuff, right? But we don't come together for the things that really matter.
Right.
So,
yep.
You know, last night we had 4 people shot on Warren Street, right? Don't hear anything about it. The violence over the 4th of July weekend, nothing from the community. It's like, you know, we normalize this stuff. And, you know, and you're right. The first, we have to hold ourselves accountable. And there's very few of us that are doing that. And we're waiting for someone else to do it. We're seeing our rights being eroded, not just here, but around the country. You know, and it's only going to get worse. So I wish I could be more optimistic, but I don't see a bright future for us and the rate we're going.
Oh, I hate that you said that, Larry. I was hoping you had more optimistic. Well, Larry, since you called, I want to ask you a question about our new commissioner, Michael. So I know
Michael
there's,
Cox.
Yes, I know there's history behind him. How well do you know him? What do you think of him as a new superintendent commissioner? The only thing I really know about this man is that he was beat up by fellow police officers and left for dead. I know since then he's done a lot more, but that's how I heard about him. So give us the 911.
Sure.
I mean the 411.
The 911.
The 411.
No, you probably the 911 because we're talking about police. I like that. It's good, no pun intended, right? So I've known Commissioner Cox, Michael Cox. We actually grew up on the same street together, so I know him, his family, quite well.
Mm-hmm.
Known him for a long time. We weren't, say, close growing up, but we knew each other. We knew each other on the job.
Mm-hmm.
Very competent, very capable individual. So I'm hoping that people aren't trying to pigeonhole him into just that the reason why he has this job is because of the assault that he took place against him. He is a capable individual. And he's more than capable of running this department. He's someone that's very soft-spoken, and you'll notice that. And I think people may confuse that as, oh, okay, you know, he's a pushover. He's not, by no means, you know. Mm-hmm. He's not someone that's going to have public spat that some people will have when they don't get their way or whatever. He's someone that you'll be able to talk to.
Mm-hmm.
And he'll listen to you. You may not always agree, but he will take the time to engage you in a way, in an adult way, and not in the spat. So I think he'll be a good addition to the department. I think the thing is that who he surrounds himself with is going to be equally important. I think a lot of times we focus on the top spot, mm-hmm. but the commission is one person,
and his team
has to be representative of him and what his mission is. So.
Right.
We'll see what that looks like, how that develops. He's definitely up for the task, and not just because of what happened.
Right. 1995. Okay. Oh, so that's when it happened in 1995. I didn't know what year it happened. But Larry, does this mean that he'll definitely be able to make critical decisions that he want to make as far as his leaders, you know, like those that are close to him, like will he be able to appoint superintendents and commanders and
right. The command staff is under his immediate supervision. They're his team. Mm-hmm. So he gets to promote people on the command staff, the deputies and the superintendents. Those are all promotions of appointments with him, and I think, and with consultation from the mayor, usually, mm-hmm. you know, that goes through City Hall, some type of vetting. But yes, so he will be able to make those changes in the department. Yes.
So, Larry, tell me how did the search go? Did you have anything to do with the search? Did you know about it? Did anyone?
I'm like Sergeant Sultz from Hogan's Hero,
uh-huh.
I knew nothing.
Wow.
I was not consulted. I believe that the mayor did speak with the current president, Dr. Jeffrey Lopes, not about the particulars, but that she would be looking for a new commissioner and what they were going to use as a process. That's about as much as I know about the process. I think, you know, someone like myself would have been added some value to things that were going on and when they were looking for a police commissioner based on my time, my 10 years as president of Mamleo, I feel I would have had something to offer to them looking for someone. But I think, you know, Commissioner Cox has a lot of those qualities. I mean, he has a very good understanding of how the police department works.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a good thing.
So he came from Michigan, right? Correct.
He was the police chief in Michigan, in Ann Arbor, Michigan, for the last 3 years, since 2019. He left here as a superintendent in charge of the police academy, the training and education component of the Boston Police Department.
Okay. So he left here to go to Michigan?
He went to Michigan. He got a job offer when he was here as a superintendent to be the chief in Michigan, and he was there for the last 3 years.
Okay.
So, but he comes back here, Priscilla, with a lot of changes as well, right? Mm-hmm. He comes back here with a lot of the unrest, a lot of, the reforms that, no other police commissioner. He will be the first Boston police commissioner to operate under the new reform process from the Pulse, which I sit on as one of the commissioners. So, mm-hmm. Before in the past, the police department, really kind of had the final say on police officers' behavior. That is not the case, not just in Boston, but statewide. So that's a huge change for a law enforcement agency that really wasn't accountable to anyone other than through the legal process of the civil service appeals. Now there is oversight in every police agency in the state. So that's going to be a big adjustment for all the leaders of the police departments here in the Commonwealth.
Mm-hmm. So... So, Larry, you think that you will be able to work really well with this new commissioner? Do you?
I look forward to working with him. Mm-hmm. I definitely, like I said, we've known each other. We know each other intimately. So we speak very frank with each other. We have in the past, and I don't see that changing now. I haven't spoken with him since this announcement. I'm sure he's busy.
Yeah.
Hopefully we will have a conversation at some point. But, I look forward to trying to be helpful in any way I can.
Right.
He's going to be the commissioner, and if he fails, the city fails.
Right. Well, I mean, it seems like our mayor, she has hired two of the top positions, the superintendent for the Boston Public Schools and now a commissioner for the police department. So let's see what other types of moves that she makes. But one thing that I, but other people really want to talk about is the elected school committee, which Boston residents voted for. And
yeah.
I understand that our mayor wants a hybrid, but I feel like if the residents of the city of Boston voted for and to go back to an elected school committee, just like we voted for the mayor, I think it needs to be on it,
And I'm glad you said it. I'm glad you framed it in that way, Priscilla, because that's the way people should frame it with the mayor, is that people voted for her because they wanted her to be the mayor. They mm-hmm. voted for an elected school committee because they wanted an elected school committee, not a hybrid. So
right.
If that's the case, then the people who voted for her opponent, Sabi George, should be able to go in and have a redo, right? They should be able to go in there and undo. And I don't think she wants that, right?
Right.
Nor should it happen.
Right.
So you can't ignore the will of the people. We're seeing that with Donald Trump wanted that, right?
Mm-hmm.
To ignore the will of the people, right? So we can't have elected officials who don't like the outcome.
Right.
Now we want to change it. Well, okay. Go back to the ballot box, but the people have spoken, and that should be respected.
That's right. Totally
agree with you.
That's true. That's so true. So, with that being said, we have a new governor coming. We have a new attorney general, a new auditor, some Senate seats, new lieutenant governors. So there's a lot of things that are going on in this city. And I'm looking at some of the candidates, and I like some of the candidates, I would love to see Tanisha Sullivan as the next Secretary of State. It's
yeah.
time. It's
I'm
time.
That, I'm in that column. I agree.
It's like
the Patti LaBelle song, though. We need to have a new attitude, right? Which I don't think, right? But
yeah.
I don't think we do, Priscilla. That's the sad part of the is I still
I mean, where are you grabbing? I mean, really? Come on. But we'll see. The voters have to make the decision, and that's why we have to advocate as much as we can for people to get out and vote. We can't tell you who to vote for, but you need to make your voice heard. Why do you think we don't get some of the things that we want? Because the elected officials don't pay no attention to us. Now, like, so look at this. So Mara Hill, so Sonya Chan dropped out, right? I don't even know why she jumped in, to be honest with you. But that's, you know, but that's good because that opened up the seat, you know, for some other folks to step up.
Somebody that's going to do something with it. So right. I'm glad she ran because I knew she was going.
We all knew that, but.
Right.
What I was going to say, Mara Healey is running for governor, and I'm still looking for her campaign office in the community. I didn't see one in Roxbury, Dorchester, Mattapan. So I would like to know, where is your campaign office, you know? And because all I see is these right. big signs that say Mara Healey for governor. Whoopie-doo.
Right. No, and I think it's a foregone conclusion that she's going to be the next governor, barring some scandal that comes out, right? Even with that, I don't think the Republicans stand a chance here, and thank God. But I think people should still not make this be a cakewalk where, you're right,
no, I
where
think
we
she
don't
needs
go
to,
in.
She needs to really identify some key things that she's going to do. I'm just so sick of business as usual in this city, you know? Yeah. I'm so sick of the backdoor deals that are made, and we're being sold. Still being sold, really, a bill of goods. So
but here's the thing, though, Priscilla. If they, like, you know, you always say, I'm sick and tired of being sick and tired, right?
Yes.
If these folks are not being held accountable in any way, then there's no reason for them to change.
That's right. Right? That's
if
true.
They can, if they can continue to give you nothing, and they don't pay a price for it, they're not going to change.
That's
look
right.
at the Republicans, right, because they know they fear Donald Trump, right, that even though they know what's in front of them, but mm-hmm. they go lockstep, right? They go lockstep, right, because it's about their interest, you know? And now that we, you know, we've been saying that, you know, that elections count, and the biggest thing that Republicans, Mitch McConnell was doing, and I had been saying this before, was he didn't care about what Donald Trump was doing. Mm-hmm. What he cared about was stacking the federal courts with, you know,
right.
these Federalist judges and stuff, right?
Yep.
And so this impact will outlive Donald Trump in the next four or five. Look at Clarence Thomas was appointed by George Bush's father.
Yep.
Right? And so he's dead and gone. But, I mean, he's been on there for 30 years. So,
wow.
And these other ones they appoint are very young. So
mm-hmm.
even when the presidency changes, and unless they change the makeup of the court,
right.
these decisions that they're making, they're not based on judicial. They're being based on politics.
Yeah,
you know. So the courts have become political as well because that's what they are now. And if we don't start electing folks at the state level, where because they're saying, oh, we're sending all this back to the states so the states can decide.
Yeah.
Well, if most of these state houses are run by Republicans, then it's just a rubber stamp
yep.
of what they want to do. And people say, well, I'm in Massachusetts in the safe, you know, right here. But guess what? They want to pass federal laws to stop people's rights on things as well. So it's not
right.
just going to be in Mississippi. What's going to happen in Mississippi will impact you here as well.
Right, right. And it's... You know, it's just so sad that they just want to take us back. But we can't let that happen. I don't know when we're going to wake up. I really don't. Probably won't be in my time, so I don't know. But the only thing I can do is just keep fighting, keep advocating, you know, keep stirring up good trouble. And
mm-hmm.
because there's nothing else that I can do right now. Just keep the movement going, you know, trying to build up some young folks that will do what we, you know, we need and want them to do. You know,
mm-hmm.
we have to train our young folks. It's really,
yeah.
God bless you. It's really, you know, so sad is what's happening in our country. You know, I mean, you keep hearing about the January 6th thing. They keep, you know, it's just like, oh my God, is it going to ever stop? Why don't they just arrest the man, put him in jail, do whatever they need to do? Because clearly he started this. And I keep hearing.
He's a criminal. What?
You say he's a criminal?
He is.
Yes.
I mean, anyone else, look, no one is above the law. And I think if you don't, see, this is, if you set a dangerous precedent, because all of this is very clear what was going on here. This, like I said, this was not ignorance of, you know, of law. This wasn't somebody who thought they won. This is someone who clearly knew that they didn't. And if I'm only going to listen to people who are telling me what I want them to tell me, knowing that it's not true, that's not a defense. You know, ignorance of the law is no defense. That's right there. So all of the people around them that were government employees were telling him, the lawyers, this is not okay. This is illegal. It's going to probably get you in trouble. And if you don't hold him accountable, then you open the door for everyone else who feels that way. And this is what happens in autocratic countries where, you know, Vladimir Putin, you know, he changed the Constitution so that he could stay president for life. Mm. You know, we don't have kings in this country and queens in this country. But that's what we will end up with if people can decide when they want, if they don't want to lose, they don't get to lose. Like you said about the mayor with the city council, the people have spoken. I mean, the school committee. There's no debate here. The people didn't vote for a hybrid. They voted for an elected school committee.
Yeah.
Just that simple. But if people don't push back on their wishes, then, you know, it'll just be, you know, business as usual.
Yeah. Well, does anybody know anything about the new school superintendent, Mary Skinner? Is that her name?
Skipper. Only thing I know that she used to be in the Boston public school system. She was a principal, I believe, and she had served some time here. But, you know, it's changed since she's left and come back. There's a lot of things going on here. There's a lot of, focus on what the state is requiring. So I almost feel like it's going to be somewhat like an MCAS. But, Priscilla, first and foremost, if you don't provide a safe environment for these kids and these teachers, nothing else is going to work. And we've seen an uptick in violence. I work in the school this school year that like I've never seen before. And I don't see that tampering down. So if you don't get that under control, because a lot of the teachers, the younger teachers, have already said they're not coming back next year.
Mm. So
they don't see a career of being abused and having to deal with this. You know, they're going to fight. They're switching gears already. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
I think Eric was going to say something.
She was also the Somerville school superintendent.
She is currently, right. She won't be able to take office, I think, until August,
right,
as well as Commissioner Cox, because they have commitments that they have to wrap up where they are. Yes.
Wow.
Yeah, but Somerville doesn't have a lot of the problems that Boston has.
Exactly.
So, the sad part is that Boston school population, when I started first working in a unit 15 years ago, there were 75,000 students in BPS.
Wow.
There are about 48,000 now.
Wow.
And we're talking about a $1.3 billion budget.
Mm-hmm.
You know, what are we getting for that money?
Yes. What? Nothing. You know, I mean, if we went from, it seems like the budget goes up as the students go down.
Well, a lot of that is operating costs, right? I mean, I was at several of the graduations this year, and Priscilla, I didn't see any more than 50 students at any of the graduation classes that graduated from BPS. No more than 50 at the graduation that I attended.
Wow.
Some of them was as small as 25.
Wow. Unbelievable. I don't know. I don't know, Larry. I think it's time for me to ease on down the road. It's so sad, you know. You want to stay here and you want to fight and advocate. But sometimes you just get so frustrated because you keep seeing the same old, you know. You really don't see a whole lot of changes. And so, but I believe, because change is coming, because change happens every day. But if we as people don't come together, if we don't, you know, get it together, it's going to always be like this. And then what are our children's children going to do, you know?
Right.
I mean, where is our wealth to lay up for our children's children? Mm-hmm. We don't have any. We're only worth $8.
Right. And to that point, you know, I heard you mention that earlier. You know, are we still? I think it was left with inflation. It's probably less than $8, right? Because everything costs more, right? So we're probably worth less. And then the fact that there was a story, a follow-up to that story that came out in the Globe over 7 years ago now, right?
Mm-hmm.
About the network. And what was interesting was that in the follow-up, they said that they needed another $250,000 to continue the study, right? Mm-hmm. To continue the study that would take another 3 years to be completed. What more do you need to study?
Exactly.
To tell you that how bad the shape we're in.
There is no need to study.
Right. So basically, when somebody needs to get paid to continue to say, you guys are in tough shape, and, you know, it's crazy to be you.
Yeah. It's sad, too, you know. Because it just seems like, you know, seems like sometimes we take one or two steps forward and we take two steps backwards. So it just seems like we never get an opportunity to get ahead.
Well, I guess you related it to carnival, right? We're like we're in carnival on a consistent basis. You know, they go one step forward, two steps back. So we just are in a continuing of carnival.
Unbelievable. Go ahead, Eric.
I was going to say, that's why it takes so long, you know. You got to change the dance.
Yes, I know. Believe me, I wish they would too. I'm like, oh my goodness, here we go. One step forward, two steps back.
Yeah.
You know, 1 mile.
Yeah.
But we seem to have accepted that this is our fate. And I guess because I'm like you all, I'm a history buff. I understand our history. And I know our folks were fighters. We had no choice.
Mm-hmm.
But we've become very complacent.
Yeah.
And that those of us who will challenge, not because they want to fight, sounds like it's confrontational, but challenge the status quo, are labeled troublemakers.
Mm-hmm.
And John Lewis said, you need some necessary trouble.
Yeah, good trouble.
Good trouble. There you go. And we don't have enough of it.
Because I don't think there's enough of us. I mean, I believe that there's enough of us. There are some folks that, you know, don't bite their tongue and stand up for different things, like Sharon Hinton. She's an advocate for education, you know. She done applied to get on the school committee about 4 times, and she still hasn't gotten there, you know.
But she doesn't get on it.
Right. But I bet if she ran for art, if was elected, I bet you she would get on there. I said they need to have, for each, we have 9 districts, right? In the city of Boston, and we have 4 at-large seats. That's 13 seats. Why couldn't we have 13 elected school committees? That means you have one for each district, and you have 4 at-large. That just makes so much sense to me. Maybe it makes too much sense, but why couldn't that happen?
Well, just like, look, if you said to the school committee or the mayor, we're not going to have an elected system, we're going to have an appointed system, they'd be like, oh, no, well, that's not fair. People have a right to a voice. So don't, you know, now that you're in charge, don't say that people don't have a right to voice, you know, at the ballot box. They decided that they don't. We're the only school system in the state that doesn't have an elected school committee.
And we're the capital. Do that make any sense? No.
But we're one of the largest, if not the largest.
Not only that, another issue that I have with the school system, especially around the charter schools, is that when the child leaves the Boston Public Schools and goes to charter school, the money go with them. But if they don't complete that year or whatever, the money don't come back. It's just insane. I mean, who makes up these laws? You know, I mean, it's just like our payment in lieu of taxes. Oh, it's voluntary. If we leave it voluntary, they'll never give us anything. You know,
I mean,
they've literally, these colleges have literally taken over Roxbury, Dorchester, not Dorchester, Roxbury, Mission Hill, Alston, Brighton. I mean, and they get away with it, and they got billions of dollars. I mean. You're a nonprofit, but you have billions of dollars. And so why can't there be some type of program or some type of law or something to make them pay something?
Well, it doesn't even have to be financials for sure, right, that they give back, right? There's no reason why they're not sending over support from their students who may be going into the education field as a work-study program, or some of the professors over there, right, paying them to work with these kids to get them up. So there's no reason. We're in the Mecca. People come from all over the world to attend colleges here, right? Yeah. There's no reason that Boston should be in this shape. Nope. This is not some, you know, little backwards hick town, and there's no schools or no universities within 100 miles. Right. I mean, these places are a stone's throw away from most of these housing developments and most of these kids, and they offer them no resource.
Yep. I said that a long time ago. They need to either offer more scholarships, or they need to offer these students to come into the Boston Public Schools and tutor these young kids.
Right. I agree. There's no reason why the Boston Public School System could be facing the situation that they were facing with us having the best schools in the country.
Yeah.
Colleges.
Thank you. Right. If you want to have somebody take over the schools, it should have been one of these colleges.
And then, and so I haven't been reading a lot about that. They're trying to put BPS in receivership. I mean, come on. I mean, really? Is it going to make any better if the state takes over the Boston Public Schools?
But then you have to ask the other question, is it going to make it any worse? Because I don't, honestly, from what I see, like I said, I have an up front row seat. I don't see these things changing. I really don't. Because I haven't seen the plan, but I can tell you what the plan has not included. It has not really addressed the public safety piece of this.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't see without that, because I'm telling you, you know, if kids are bringing guns in and more this year, and the violence, tasers and the violence, you know, and they're not using the Chromebooks for learning, they're using them to assault each other. I just don't see a change here.
Yeah. But it's coming. It is.
So is it the fall of the winter? Yeah,
We need more people who are not afraid to stand up, to speak out, you know, because there's just so many, you know, a lot of times when you say something or you speak out of something, you get penalized. You know, you may work for the city, or you may work for the state, or, you know, you may work for BPS. So then you're labeled as a troublemaker. Well, in this city, you got to make trouble. Because if you don't, I mean, life will just pass you by, and you'll be looking around like, what in the world happened to Boston?
Right. Well, on the school part, the parents have to be more engaged and more invested in their kids, you know?
I mean, agree.
You know, because the parents who can navigate, that can get their kids into METCO or even in some of the charter schools that are doing better in some areas, you know, but there's no reason, like I said, the amount of money that's being spent, the result. I mean, just imagine if you had a company that was putting out $1.3 billion a year and you were getting nothing in return, you would have shut it down.
Mm-hmm. That's the truth.
This is tax dollars.
That's right. This is our money. This is our money.
Right. You know, the city. It's not the city's money. I tell people, name me one thing that the city produces, or the state, or the government. When they talk about the government, I tell them, name me one thing that they produce to make money. They don't. They take it from others.
Yeah.
In taxes.
Yep.
So don't talk about it's their money. No, it's my money.
That's right. I don't know.
Why is it in suburban towns where they hold their elected officials accountable? Because, yeah, they might pay higher taxes, but they demand higher services for it as well.
Right, right. And then we also have to look at the prison system. When you look at Conkin and Shirley and Walpole and Norfolk, all these prisons that are outside of Boston, but mostly all the inmates live from Roxbury, Dorchester, Mattapan, unfortunately, you know. So they get more money for housing or incarcerating our people, and yet they get the benefit of having, you know, a larger piece of the pie.
Yeah, right, because they count by, that's what the census, right? So, right, if you've got 12,000 people from Roxbury, Dorchester, Mattapan in Norfolk, then Norfolk gets additional funding, even though it's not like these people are homeowners or anything, right?
Right. But, have you driven through Gardner at all? Do you see how smooth and stuff their streets are?
I haven't been to Gardner in years.
That's where the Gardner prison inn is, so they're getting all that extra money with all the people living here. But you know, and they're a small town, so
they are small. You could blink and go right, through Gardner. Exactly. I mean, it's like one street.
You know, they got nice new fire trucks and all these nice smooth streets and stuff. So they're benefiting from having that prison in Gardner.
No, but that's because, like I said, folks are working together. We're so fractured here, you know. And a lot of times, you know, we're looking for the next handout. I'm like, a handout is just that. It's not a hand up.
Right.
You know, it's and at some up. Point, like, all of this stimulus, it's all going away. People got so used to it. It's like, no, this was just a temporary thing. And somebody had to pay for it. And now it's going away. The people, what am I going to do? Well, you had time to come up with a plan.
That's
you know,
right.
This
I
would
knew.
Have been a
go ahead.
No, I'm saying this would have been a great opportunity for us to get our act together while we had all this downtime, you know, but we didn't.
Yeah. I know some people actually with their stimulus money started nonprofit organizations, you know? Because we have to start thinking about how we can profit, how we can make our own money. There's a lot of businesses, a lot of people that had businesses that were made because of COVID, you know. So however, how do we turn that into money maker for us? Like I always say about Facebook, if we're going to use Facebook we need to use it as an organizing tool. The same thing with Zoom. You can get thousands of people on Zoom from all across the country. Why aren't we organizing? You know, I mean, we should be able to across this state. I mean, there's so many people that have been gentrified out. I believe if a lot of them people ran for office in those little towns like Lowell or Lawrence or Orange or even Randolph or Stoughton, all these places. You know, that our people have been gentrified out. Why, you know, especially those that are active, you know, that know what goes on, why aren't they running for office, you know? And that way, that would change the way the state house looks. Because that's what needs to happen, you know. We need to change.
Right.
Larry, can you believe we got 2 minutes?
I know.
You know, we're considered New England based on, you know, across the pond. So Randolph or one of the Brockton should be renamed New Boston.
I agree. But, we just have to keep fighting. We can't, you know, go down. We can't stop doing what we're doing. You know, hopefully we'll bring up some young folks that will see and help take up the mantle. Because I'm telling you, I'm on the other side of 65, and I don't know. It's getting weary. Well, I only have 1 minute, Larry. So I thank you for calling, being my guest.
Yeah.
Hopefully, I'll reach out to Mel and find out what happened, but it's all good. But I would suggest that people, you know, go on the Facebook.com and put in T Riders Union. There's a meeting. There's going to be a meeting Monday at 2201 Washington Street in Roxbury, Suite 302. So thank you, Larry.
Hey, Larry, can you give me a call after the broadcast?
Hello?
Larry?
He's gone.
Oh.
Okay, this is it. People Power with Priscilla. We are the people, and we have the power, people. Let's use it. God bless. See you next Thursday. Stay cool and calm. We out.
Pastor.